So it is my privilege to introduce to the congregation, our church family, Pastor Joseph Kidder. God has blessed you, Pastor Joe, blessed you as a young follower of Jesus in Iraq, blessed you as a husband and a father, blessed you as a successful pastor and an influential professor at the Adventist Seminary at Andrews University, as a writer and somebody who does a lot of traveling. Encouraging people in their walk with the Lord. You'll notice that the theme this afternoon is experiencing God, and that's really a part of the theme this morning as well, because he's going to share of his experience of God, and I know that's going to be an encouragement to all of you today. One little change from our original plan: we were planning to meet in the fellowship hall after lunch at 1:45. We've decided to meet in here, so we encourage you to come and join us this afternoon. It'll be a blessing, and I think, Pastor Joe, you're going to say a little bit more about that before we're all done here this morning. So we want to begin with prayer, and we just want to give you as much time as you can take for this special time. Heavenly Father, we are just so grateful that we can all be together today here in Jesus' name. We thank you for bringing Pastor Joe here from his home in Bering Springs, Michigan, that he was able to make it yesterday and that he's here this morning. We thank you for how we've already been blessed by his ministry here this weekend. And we just ask now that you would give him a fresh anointing of your Holy Spirit. And as your Spirit falls upon Pastor Joe, oh Lord, may it fall upon all of us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. We went to college together. And my hair was shiny black at that time. But look what happened to me. Yeah. I am really so honored and happy to be with you. I have been praying for you, praying for this weekend. And I know that the Lord will bless us. I am going to share with you how I found Jesus in Iraq. But before I do this, I noticed that you participate in the Operation Christmas Child. Well, let me tell you an interesting story. A few years ago, when Saddam Hussein was the president of Iraq, Operation Christmas Child decided to send several thousands of children over there, some boxes, shoe boxes. Well, they went to Jordan. I think they sent 6,000 or more. And they put them on a truck to take them to Baghdad. On the border, Saddam Hussein confiscated the truck. He asked the people who were driving the truck, "What is this for?" So they told him that these are gifts to poor children coming from the U.S., and there are some toys and other things in it. So he took those 6,000 shoe boxes and he put just a piece of paper like this, saying, "This is a gift from Saddam Hussein." And they distributed to all of the people in Baghdad. 6,000 families got it, a gift from Saddam Hussein. But later on, people here in this country who gave these gifts started to get telephone calls, internet, email about how to accept Jesus Christ. Here is what happened that Saddam Hussein did not know: that in every one of those shoe boxes, there was an Arabic Bible and a brochure of how to accept Jesus Christ. Four steps to accepting Jesus Christ. It is so amazing how God works. He wanted to get the credit for it, and by doing so, he gave them permission to become Christians in a Muslim country. So I hope we can send more, maybe to Nineveh or to Baghdad, maybe another 6,000 boxes. I was going to show you some pictures about Iraq. That was the wrong picture, reminding you of the Thanksgiving dinner. this is the wrong one. It's the other one. No, no. There is another one I put for you. No. It's on the side to the right at the bottom. It says Iraq Pictures. Okay, I will start talking while they are doing this. Or maybe. I was born in the city of Nineveh. I am the product of Jonah. Literally, Jonah is still preaching up to today. Well, up to last year. Because his grave was at the downtown area of the city of Mosul. That's the modern name for the city. Here it is. Okay. This is the map of Iraq, and Mosul is the modern name for the city of Nineveh. Baghdad is the capital, and about 60 miles to the west of Baghdad is Babylon, right over here. And Nasiriyah, that's where Abraham came from. There is something very interesting about Nasiriyah. Does anybody know the king who came up with a law that was considered the first law outside of the Bible? Does anybody remember that? Hammurabi. Very good. Yes. No. Okay, as they are doing this, how many children do we have who are 12 years or younger? Let me see your hands, please. 12 years or younger. I see several. I want you to listen to the sermon very carefully. I have three questions for you. Question number one is, why it is so difficult to be a Christian in the Middle East? Why it is so difficult to be a Christian in the Middle East? Question number two, one day my cousin forced me to go to a park with him, and he asked me a very significant question that changed his life. And thirdly, what happened to my mother? Now, if you get the right answer, just come and see me at the back. If you get the right answer, you could get two pieces of dessert today at potluck. If you are more than 12 years old, you do not qualify for this. So only for 12 years and younger. Okay. Okay, this is the political map of Iraq. The reason I put this one for you is, do you see Nineveh? That's Nineveh in Arabic. So the state is called the State of Nineveh, and this is this area here. And Mosul, of course, is on the news all the time nowadays. The Iraqi army with the Kurdish army, with the help of the American, are trying to overtake Mosul back from ISIS. Because in June of 2014, ISIS occupied the city. I think we're having problem with this. Okay. So this is basically the state of Nineveh. Let's go. I think we're just going to ignore it. I'm just going to tell you the story. Yeah. About 38 years ago, by divine providence, I ended up going to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I was beaten almost to death and was abandoned by my family and thrown out on the street. I lost 2 years of education and a scholarship that covered 4 years. That was 38 years ago. But about 9 years ago, I discovered I am alive today because of that experience. And over the years, I discovered that the Lord have given me wonderful blessings that I never expected. The theme is that God makes all things to work for good for those who love Him. Yeah. This, by the way, is the first recorded writing in history, and it comes from the southern part of Iraq. Let's see if this will work now. No, it's not working. Well, just ignore it. What? Go ahead. So this is the map of the whole area. Keep going. This is at the entrance of the city of Babylon. Next slide. This is the Gate of Ashtar, very famous. The original one is in the museum in Berlin. This is the fake one in Iraq. Next one. These are the walls of the city of Nineveh. Those are 2,700 years old, but they are standing up to today. Next slide. More of the walls of the city of Nineveh. Next slide. Next one. Six gates. Next one. Another one. Another one. Four museums. This is one of them. Unfortunately, all of these museums were destroyed last October. And all of the churches and all of the seminaries, Mosul was really the stronghold of Christianity in Iraq. And most of the Christian in Iraq came from Mosul, and it was all destroyed last October. Next one. The walls from the south side of the city. Next one. Another museum. Next one. Another one. Next one. This is Nineveh, the way it looked like at the time of Jonah. And literally, they used to have romantic rites on the Tigris River. This is the destruction that they experienced last October. He was supposed to go to Nineveh from Joppa. That's where Jonah came from. Next slide. The distance to Nineveh is 550 miles. He ended up going 2,500 miles. Next one. This is the grave of Jonah. And in Iraq, especially in the northern section, all of the people historically were supposed to fast the fast of Jonah, 3 days, 3 nights without water or food. ISIS put a stop to that last October. Next slide. It was destroyed last October. This is the letter they put on the homes of the Christian. 235,000 Christians who lived in Nineveh at that time. And they gave them the option of either converting to Islam or leaving the city. All of them left except for 9 people, which should really serve as an inspiration to all of us to stay faithful to God. Next slide. The Christian community is about 300,000 today, half Catholic, half Orthodox. And this is an Orthodox church. And that was an Orthodox church in Baghdad. But this one is the only Seventh-day Adventist church in the whole country. We have a country of 37 million people with only one church. I mean, think about it. Salem is 160,000, and there are 5 churches. Iraq only has 1 church building. Next slide, please. Go to the last one, next one. The church was bombed 8 times. So now they have the deacons protecting it. And you thought being a deacon was a hard job. Imagine being a deacon in Iraq. I'm not kidding you. The people from the inside are really the deacons. Those are soldiers from the government. Let's pray and ask God to be with us. Our Father in heaven, really, it is an awesome responsibility to come and speak on your behalf. And I feel so inadequate. But I am praying that you will speak through me, that you will give me the words to say, and that people will at the end say, what a great and awesome God we have. And that it will inspire us more to be more faithful to you and connect with you. And that we will have more hunger and desire to connect with you. In Jesus' name, amen. When I was a young man, I wanted to be a professional soccer player. And my idol in life was Pelé. I don't know how many of you remember that name. Let me see your hands. That's like the greatest soccer player of all time. I didn't make it, unfortunately. But on a Friday afternoon, I called my cousin to come and practice soccer with me. We came from Nineveh, but my father was a businessman who decided to move all of his businesses from Nineveh to Baghdad to expand them. And many of my cousins and uncles who worked for my dad moved with us to Baghdad. So on that Friday afternoon, I invited my cousin to come and practice soccer with me. My cousin was not into soccer. So we played for 20 minutes. And he said, I'm done. I don't like this. I said, what would you like to do? He said, we are new to this city. Let's explore it. Let's go for a walk. So we started walking on the streets of Baghdad. And by divine providence, we came to this church. It was just right in front of us. In Iraq, you cannot do any form of evangelism, no public evangelism, no personal evangelism. But the pastor of this church was creative. So he was showing a movie about the life of Christ, and he had an advertisement, smaller than my Bible, right next to the gate of the church. My cousin saw the ad, and he looked at me, and he said, we don't have anything to do. Let's go in and watch the movie. Maybe we will learn something in you. And we went in, and we sat on this side of the church. And for the first time in my life, I saw Jesus on the screen. I saw his birth, his teaching, his miracles, his death, and his resurrection. And I fell in love with him. I was amazed. It was just a wonderful experience. I was thrilled. So at the end of the movie, I went to the pastor and asked him if I could learn more about Jesus. Later on, I learned this man was the pastor of this church for 28 years. But I was the first Bible study he ever have had from outside of the church. Imagine 28 years of discouragement. I made his career for him. He will never forget me. We studied the Bible for 4 months, and I loved that time. We met on Tuesday evening, and my love for Jesus increased. And one day, I went to the church to have another Bible study, but we didn't have one. He looked at me and he said, you have been coming here for several months. You have learned a lot about Jesus. You need to make a commitment to him. You need to accept him into your heart. That was very difficult for me because I grew up in a culture, if you change your faith, they kill you. They ostracize you. They shun you. They persecute you. And I didn't want any of that stuff to happen to me. So I quit the Bible study. But praise the Lord, God never gave up on me. I felt the nudge of the Holy Spirit every day. And finally, I just couldn't handle it anymore. So I decided to go back again for another Bible study. And this time, we had a Bible study on the Ten Commandments. I didn't have any problem with the Ten Commandments, except for one. Guess which one? The fourth one, the Sabbath one. Ironically, the language I grew up in, Arabic, we don't have names for the days of the week. So Sunday, we call it the first day. Monday, the second day. The only one that had a name was the seventh day. We called it the Sabbath. That's the name of it in Arabic. And it means a day of rest. And the pastor said, God kept it. Jesus kept it. The disciples kept it. We're going to keep it in heaven. Why don't we keep it today? That made perfect sense to me. My problem was that the day off in Iraq is Friday. And everybody is forced to go to school, to work on the Sabbath. And I said to myself, I will never have any future in Iraq. I will never be able to finish my education, never be able to find a job. So I left and I was very, very disturbed. And I decided I needed a second opinion. So I went and visited with a Greek Orthodox pastor. After I explained to him my dilemma, he lifted up the Bible like this. And he said, if you go by the Bible, you need to keep the seven-day Sabbath holy. I could have strangled this man. I was so disappointed with him. I said, this is not what I wanted to hear from you. Incidentally, up to today, some pockets of the Orthodox Church in the Middle East that either believe in the Sabbath or some even keep it up to today. Well, a few weeks later, I went and visited with a Catholic priest. He said, we changed the day. Well, I wanted a biblical answer. So I decided to go and visit with the pastor of the largest Protestant church. And at that time, it was the Presbyterian church. And their church was right behind this building over here. And unbeknown to me, the Adventist pastor befriended the Presbyterian pastor. And he gave him a gift one day. It was a book called The Great Controversy. He read the book, so when I met with him, he said, I have been struggling with this issue myself, and I have come to the conclusion that we really need to keep the seven-day Sabbath holy. I said, I came to you to tell me something different. He became an Adventist, and I watched his baptism, and he was kicked out of his church. But then I left, and I said, I'm not going to go and talk to any other pastor. They all are going to tell me the same thing. I said to myself, what difference does it make? Just pick a day and worship God on it. But the Holy Spirit reminded me that we are in the mess we are in today because two people said, what difference does it make if you're out of this tree or that tree? They all are trees. It's not about the tree. It's not even about the day, but it's about our love and allegiance and loyalty to Jesus. Well, at that time, I graduated from high school. And Iraq had a weird system. You graduate from high school with a certain GPA, you are eligible to take another exam. And at this exam, if you score in the 90 percentile and above, you could go to any college of your choice for free. But there was a catch to it. If you score 70 or below, you go to the army. Well, nobody in a country like that would like to go to the army. I studied very, very hard. I did not leave my house for 3 months preparing for that test. I took the test, and I scored high enough to go to the School of Engineering for free for 4 years. I wanted to be an engineer from the day I was born. Not because I have any passion for engineering. They just make more money than anybody else in that country. And I really wanted to make more money than anybody else, but it was not a good thing for me. Because for a whole year, I did not feel any need for God. I didn't go to church, didn't read the Bible, hardly ever prayed. Well, fast forward with me to the end of the school year. At the university in Baghdad, there was a tradition. All of the exams come on one day. It was the Sabbath day, you guessed it. You start at 10 o'clock in the morning and you go to 6 and you are done. Well, the Sunday before that, something very unusual happened. My mother was a casual Christian. But one thing was clear about my mother. She was very consistent about her church attendance. My mother went to church twice a year, Christmas and Easter. Oh, she was consistent about that. But that Sunday, before the final exams, there was a big celebration at her church. And she wanted to go. And as you know, when you are not in the habit of going every week, it's really hard to go. So she came to me and she begged me to go to church with her. I came up with every excuse I could come up with not to go to church, and finally I failed. I don't know whether it was to please her or get her off my back. I said, fine, I will go to church with you. The church my mother belonged to had 20,000 members with one pastor. They cannot find pastors in the Middle East. And if you go to that church on a regular Sunday, there will be less than 100 elderly women in church. But on Christmas and Easter, they might be 10, 15,000 people. We went to the church. The cathedral was jam-packed. We sat in the back. And they went through 1 hour of ritual. And then the pastor, who was sitting on a high chair in the back, came down and he looked at the congregation and he said, my heart is troubled. He said, something happened to me last night that never have happened to me before. He said, the Lord woke me up in the middle of the night and gave me a new message for you. And this new message is on martyrdom, which is dying for Jesus. He said, I don't know why I have to do this, because it's supposed to be celebration, but God asked me to preach on this. Now, for someone who have not been to church for a whole year, that was the last topic I wanted to hear anything about. I mean, you want to go to church to feel good, not to hear about death. But that sermon that day changed my life forever. I'd like you to open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter 19. We're going to read verses 27 to 29. Matthew 19, 27 to 29. Then Peter answered and said to him, he's talking to Jesus, see, we have left all to follow you. What are we going to have as a result of following you? He's saying, what will be the consequences? What will be the rewards? What will happen to us? So Jesus said to them, assuredly I say to you that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man sits on the throne of his glory, you who have followed me will also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. But this is really the main text. And everyone who has left houses, sometimes, if you are going to follow Jesus, you have to leave your house. Sometimes you have to leave your brothers, sisters, father, mother, wife, children, lands, bank accounts, cars, for my name's sake. You have to leave it for the sake of Jesus. Then you will have eternal life. And the pastor said that Jesus left heaven, went all the way to the cross and died for us. Shouldn't we, out of love for him, do the same? He said the disciples had to leave their homes. The issue that I was struggling with. They left their moms and dads to follow Jesus. They are our example. We need to do the same. And I'm sitting in church with 3,000 people. And I felt God's presence in such a way I have never felt it before. I felt like God was all around me, inside of me. I felt like heaven was opened up and I saw him sitting on the throne, like Isaiah saw him on the throne. And I started to cry. It just dawned on me at that moment what Jesus has done for me. He died on the cross so I could live and have eternity with him. And I determined at that moment that I will follow Jesus no matter what. The worship service was over. I looked at my mom and I said to her, "You go home and I will see you there later on." And I left the Orthodox Church and started walking on the streets of Baghdad, filled with fear of what will happen to me if I follow Jesus. I thought about every problem that I could face. 5 hours later, I ended up being at the home of the Seventh-day Adventist pastor. I told him about my experience in the Orthodox Church and my decision to follow Jesus, but I said, "I am filled with fear. I don't know what to do." He said, "Let me tell you a story." He told me the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. How many of you know that story? That story happened exactly 60 miles from my home in Baghdad. But listen to the insight he gave me. He said, "Those three friends prayed that God will deliver them from the fire. But God, in his infinite wisdom, decided to deliver them in the fire." He said, "Think about it. Because God decided to deliver them in the fire, they had the greatest worship experience of their lives. While they were there in the fire, God showed up. Jesus was there with them." Amazing. He walked with them. They worshiped him right there in the fire in front of thousands of people. He said, "Because God decided to deliver them in the fire, they experienced the power of God." The Bible tells us that the people who threw them into the fire got evaporated from the intensity of the heat. Nothing happened to them. Imagine. The Bible says not even the smell of smoke was on them. And because God decided to deliver them in the fire, they became an inspiration to all of us. Imagine the thousands of times that story have been told to give encouragement to people. Here we are. We're 10,000 miles from where this story happened. 2,500 years from the time it happened. And we're telling it today to encourage our faith. And then the pastor looked at me and he said, "God is speaking to you. You need to give your heart to Jesus." I said, "I want to." Well, he said, "Pray after me." And for the first time in my life, I prayed and I gave my heart to Jesus. And I want to tell you, it is a decision I never felt sorry about. I have felt sorry about many decisions I have made, but this is the one I am always so happy I made it. And the pastor said, "Well, you need to get baptized." I said, "I want to." He said, "Well, let's do it next Sabbath." As I was leaving, he looked at me and he said, "Look, I'm going to get the whole church to pray for you, that God will deliver you from the fire, but be prepared to go into the fire." The following Sabbath came. Exams, 10 o'clock. And we're talking about a country where education is extremely important. You will never have any future without it. And the baptism is scheduled for 11:30. And I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and I couldn't move. I was paralyzed. And I heard a voice saying, look, you have broken thousands of Sabbaths before. One more is not going to make much difference. But then I heard the voice of God say, it's not about the Sabbath, it's about me. How much you trust in me, how much you love me. And then I heard the other voice saying, you do not want to lose a whole year just because of a few hours. And then I heard the voice of God saying, it's not about a year, it's about eternity. Accepting Jesus has eternal significance to it. And then I heard the other voice saying, just go do it. God will understand. And then I heard the voice of God saying, just trust in me. I will take care of you. I will carry you through. I kept struggling all the way from 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and about 11 o'clock, God gave me the victory. And I decided I'm going to follow Jesus no matter what. So I got out of bed, put some clothes on, and I ran to the church. When I arrived, the worship service was over, but most of the people were out in the foyer. So they brought them back in, and we had the baptism. I will never forget that day. I lost the year, but I gained Jesus. That's really what's important in life, is to gain Jesus. I lost the second year for the same reason. I pleaded with my professors to allow me to take the exams on a different day, but they wouldn't. And because I lost 2 years, I was kicked out of the university. They felt like I was too dumb to spend any more money on. When my dad saw all of this happening to me, he brought 100 people into our living room in Baghdad, a large room, and I was right in the middle, surrounded by 100 people who would never have come if I was criminal or on drugs, but they came to talk me out of being faithful to God. They talked and talked and talked, and finally when my dad saw that I was not going to change my mind, he took off his shoes and threw them on me, which in the Middle East represent inflicting shame on that individual. Actually, it happened twice in the last few years. One of them was when President Bush went to Iraq a few years ago and they threw the shoe on him. And then when Hillary Clinton a few years ago went over there and they did the same thing to her. Well, that gave permission to one of my brothers and one of my cousins to come and lift me up by my shoulders and start beating on me. When I accepted Jesus, I became shame to the family. And they did this till I started to bleed all over. I became unconscious, and they thought I was dead. And as part of this cleansing ceremony, they threw me out on the street. But miraculously, God saved my life. And a few hours later, I came back to consciousness, and I looked up into the skies, and I said, Lord, I feel like since I decided to follow you, I lost everything. My school, my friends, my family. And I heard him saying to me, maybe, but now you got me. And if you have Jesus, that's all what you need in life. I said, Lord, I feel like the whole world is against me. He said, maybe, but I am for you. And if Jesus is for us, it doesn't matter who is against us. Well, in this church, at that time, there were about 175 people. But in that mix, there was a young couple who were the youth leaders of that church, who took an interest in me. Every time I went to church, they would come and talk to me and pray with me and encourage me. So I decided to go to their home. And they were wonderful people. I stayed with them for several months. And one of the things we did every day was we read the Bible and we claimed promises. They told me there are more than 3,000 promises in the Bible, one to meet every need. But there was one we read every night. Let me read it for you. And we know, that's Romans 8:28. I'm sure all of you know this. And we know, the Greek says, and we are convinced beyond any shadow of doubt that how many things work for good for those who love him? Can we say it with really as much enthusiasm as we can? How many things? All things work for good for those who love God. Now remember this when bad things happen to you. Well, this family I was staying with said, you really don't have any future in Iraq. And they suggested I go to study at Middle East College in Beirut, Lebanon. It's a very small Adventist college in Beirut. I applied to go, but I couldn't go because it was not accredited. And right after that, the war between the Arab countries and Israel started. And Iraq, being part of the Arab countries, started to draft people to send them to the army. And one day I got the letter in the mail that I needed to report for duty in the army in 6 weeks. It was the worst day of my life. My father heard about it. He wrote me a letter saying, look, if you renounce your faith, I'll accept you back home. And I'll find a way for you to leave the country and go to Europe to study and avoid the army. I was very tempted to take my dad up on his offer. But praise the Lord for the community of faith. They prayed for me. They encouraged me. Later on, I learned that the Apostle Paul, 59 times, that's a lot, tells us to pray for one another. That's what the church is all about. Loving each other, encouraging each other, loving and being available to each other. I would never have been able to stand here in front of you if it wasn't for the prayers and encouragement of my church in Baghdad. My neighbor, who was my best friend, got a letter similar to the one I got. But he was a little bit older than me. So he went to the army right away. And in 1 week, the news came back he was killed. So they had a memorial service for him. And my mom went to that service. And she was emotionally moved. She came home to my dad. And she said, I don't care. Whatever my son is, I don't care. I just want to see him. It took some convincing. But finally, my dad accepted me back home. It was first night I was home. It was about 10:30 at night. I was asleep in my bed when the brother and the cousin who lifted me up by my shoulders came to me and said, we need to go for a walk. I was terrified. I protested. I fought against it, but they wouldn't let it go. They dragged me out of bed, and they took me for a walk. I tried to run away from them, but they held on to my arms. And we went to a park 4 miles from where we lived. We got to the park, midnight, not a light, no people, nobody, nothing. We got to the middle and they stopped. So I said, this is the end. And I started to pray and give my heart to Jesus. 5 minutes, nothing happened. 7 minutes, and I just said, Lord, my life is in your hands. Protect me, if that would be possible. Just be with me. I was anticipating a knife stab or a shot. 10 minutes, nothing. Finally, my cousin broke the silence. He said, look, you are either crazy to go through what you went through, or you have something we would like to have. So I had the privilege of sharing my faith with my brother and with my cousin. And we were there till 6 in the morning. At 6 in the morning, my brother gave his heart to Jesus Christ. And my cousin today is the pastor of this church. Praise the Lord. We do have a God who makes all things to work for good for those who love Him. I really solicit your prayers on their behalf. I have been praying for my two brothers to come here. And about 2 years ago, I met my brother after not seeing him for 36 years in the airport in Kalamazoo, Michigan, for the first time. I mean, it was a miracle that God answered our prayers right there. And we're praying for my other brother to come here. My cousin actually left the country and went to Lebanon. But one day in his devotion, he asked the question, who is going to take care of God's work in Iraq? So he went back again to Iraq. And today, we have this church. We have another church, right? Oh, this keeps coming back all the time. Go back again to the, just put that map back. We have a church that my cousin is planting in the northern section of Iraq, right on the border of Kurdistan and Turkey and Nineveh. And there is about 15 to 20 people who go to that church today. And the South American division sent a missionary from Sao Paulo to Erbil, that's the capital of Kurdistan. And he also planted a church over there, and there is about 30 people in that church. Here, I'll show you. Right over here is the new church, and the other one is right over here. And of course, we have a church in Baghdad. So now we have three little places where believers gather from time to time when it is safe to worship God. Pray for them. I ask Pastor Rick if you like to help with these churches. We will have an offering, a free will offering at the end. And he said that would be just fine if you like to help these churches. I still have to tell you how I'm alive today. But I want you to listen to this story. The family I was staying with said, we still have to solve the problem of the army. Because if you don't leave the country, you are going to go to the army. And then they said this. They said the church in Iraq for 40 years have been trying to get Middle East College to be accredited, and they failed. They tried briberies, connection, influence, nothing worked. So somebody said, why don't we try prayer? So about 50 people went into the basement of this church on a Friday evening, and they were there till Sunday afternoon. They fasted, they prayed, and they worshiped God. And I cannot explain this to you. Nobody in the world can. On a Tuesday of that week, they got the letter from the Minister of Education that Middle East College was accredited. 40 years of a human effort failed and failed miserably. But when God's people prayed, God did it. My advice to you is don't even wait for 40 seconds. Take whatever you got to the Lord and He will take care of you. I went to Beirut, Lebanon to study, and shortly after I arrived, the civil war started. I had nothing to do with it. It just coincided with my arrival over there. So somebody came to me and said, you still want to study engineering? I said, yes. He said, go to Walla Walla College. And my first reaction was, who in his right mind will go to Walla Walla? Because Walla Walla in Arabic sounds like the place of the double curse. And names in Arabic have meaning. So I thought, this must be a bad place. I'm sure many graduates of Walla Walla are here. They told me, no, it's an Indian name, means the land of many waters. My church prayed for me for 13 months. Every Wednesday night, every Sabbath morning, they lifted up my name in a prayer. They fasted, many of them fasted once a week on my behalf. And miraculously, I got the visa and I came to Walla Walla. And I took double major engineering and theology. And I worked as an engineer for 3 months. That was the dream of my life. But God has a different plan for me. So I pastored for 21 years in the Northwest, in Upper Columbia. And we loved it. And then I went to teach at the seminary 16 years ago. But 12 years ago, the war between the United States and Iraq started. 9 years ago, I have a female pastor who came to this country many years ago to do advanced medical training, and she never went back again to Iraq. But 9 years ago, she decided to go to Iraq to see how our family are doing. And being a female at that time, she thought she is safe, not anymore. But she spent a month over there. When she came back, I went to see her, and she said, sit down, you will never believe what I'm going to tell you. She said, your mom now is praising the Lord for your faithfulness every day. I said, my mom kicked me out of home. She said, your mom now goes to the Adventist church. She's studying the Bible with your cousin. She's going to be baptized. I said, that doesn't make any sense. My mom kicked me out of home because I decided to follow Jesus and keep the Sabbath. She said, you are alive today because you decided to be faithful to Jesus. See, after I left the country, the war between Iraq and Iran started. 1 million people died in that war. Most of them are in my age group. And then there was a war with Kuwait and 3 wars with the United States. Another 1 million people died. But I am alive. I did not know for 30 years. I am alive today because I decided to follow Jesus. We do have a God who makes all things to work for good for those who love Him. My mom was baptized about 9 years ago. And she died 3 months after her baptism. She was diabetic and there were no adequate medication. I wish I was there, but I will see her in heaven. We have a wonderful God. And I really urge you to follow Him and to be faithful to Him always. I want just to share with you a few lessons from this story. Always be faithful to God, no matter what. For me, the test was the Sabbath. But every one of us here have some kind of a test that we struggle with. Don't focus on that problem. Focus on the greatness of our God. I'm ashamed to tell you, that's all what I focus on. Just problems. What will happen to me if I follow Jesus? This problem and that and that. And they all happen. And it didn't matter because God eventually made them all work for good. That's the kind of God we have. Focus on His greatness, on His power. Did you know that we have 7 stories in the Bible to tell us that our God could do the impossible? The first story, one day God came to a woman who was 91 years old. She was barren all her life. Her husband was 100 years old. And she said, I'm going to give you a child. You know what she did? She laughed. She thought it was a joke. After all, she was a candidate for the nursing home, not the maternity ward. A woman 91 years old, but God did it. He specializes in doing the impossible. Thousands of years later, he came to a virgin, a young lady, 18 years old, 19. He said, I'm going to give you a child. She didn't ask how. She just believed in him, and she had the privilege of becoming the mother of Jesus. One day he came to a little boy. He said, do you see that giant? If you trust in me, you could defeat him. And today he is coming to you and to me. And he says, if you trust in me, you could move mountains. You see those cascades? You could move those. But more importantly, whatever difficulty you have in your life, God is bigger than that. Whether it is marital problem, health problem, financial, whatever the problem you face, God is bigger than that. When I was at Middle East College, I went to one of the professors. And I said, I really need to leave this country and go to the United States to study. He said, that is impossible. It would never happen. I said, why not? He said, first, you don't know the language. You don't have money. And these are the minor problems. I said, what is the major problem? He said, well, the United States is not accepting anybody from Iraq. And then he did this. I will never forget this. He said, it is easier for Moses to take the children of Israel out of Egypt into the promised land than for you to go from Iraq to the United States. What a man of encouragement he was. What kind of faith is this? Forgetting the point, it wasn't Moses who did it, it was God who did it. And that same God is available to all of us. And then pray like your life depends on it. I saw the power of prayer. 40 years of a human effort trying to get Middle East College to be accredited, and they failed. But when the church prayed, God did it. And then the church prayed for me for 13 months. They fasted. And then I got the visa from the United States. And Saddam Hussein, an evil dictator, signed my passport as a special case to leave that country to come over here. That's the power of prayer. God does miracles, the impossible. Pray like your life depends on it. Connect with him on a regular basis. I had a wonderful time this morning. I went for a walk, 1 hour and 10 minutes. I had a wonderful communion with the Heavenly Father. I encourage all of you to do that. Go for prayer walks every day. And then be patient with God. I'm telling you a story that I myself did not know the significance of it till about 9 years ago. But it has been in the making for almost 40 years. I didn't know that when I decided to follow Jesus that my brother will follow him, that my cousin today will be the pastor of the church over there. I didn't know that. But we have to trust in Jesus. And I don't know how many years it will take for you to know how God made all things to work for good for you. But I know God does. You know, we are conditioned by the McDonald's syndrome. We want things to happen instantaneously to us. I was visiting with my son in Seattle when he was living there a few years ago. And I was driving the car and he was sitting next to me. And he said, Dad, I am hungry. Can we stop somewhere to eat? I ignored him because we have a destination to get to. 2 or 3 minutes later, he said, Dad, I am hungry. I ignored him. 2 or 3 minutes later, he said, Dad, I am dying from starvation. Well, I didn't want my son to die in the land of plenty. So I immediately stopped at Taco Bell. And in less than 2 minutes, my son was resuscitated back to life. I saved my son. But with God, Sometimes it might take 10 years. Here is the most exciting thing I am going to share with you. Someday soon, there will be a table going from here to eternity. And Jesus will be at the head of this table. You will be there, you will be there, you will be there. I will be there. And He will personally tell you how He made all things to work for good for you. I hardly could wait for that day. He will tell you how even sometimes you didn't see Him, He was right there behind the scene, protecting you and loving you and carrying you through. I love that. And the last lesson, always be attentive to hear the voice of God. I heard the voice of God through the voice of the Greek Orthodox pastor. And I said yes to the Lord. And my life was never the same. I know God is speaking to your hearts right now. And I want to give you an opportunity to respond. We're going to be singing, I Surrender All. And as we're going to sing it, I'd like you to come to the front. Maybe you would like to come to the front to tell Jesus, I love you more than anything. Maybe you would like to come to the front because you have a burden in your life and you don't want to struggle with that burden anymore. Maybe you like to come to the front because you have been drifting away. And today is your opportunity to make a new beginning with Jesus. And there might be here some people or on the internet who are listening to us who never have accepted Jesus before. I want to tell you it's worth it to do it. And we have two pastors over here. Please come and talk to them and they will be able to help you with that. I made many decisions in my life and I felt sorry about many of them. But this is the one I'm always proud of. Following Jesus changed my life. And change it for eternity. Let's all stand up and let's sing, I Surrender All. And as we are singing, just come to the front. Just say, Lord, I love you more than anything else. If you come closer, I surrender all. Thank you. We sing the last one. People always ask me, is it really worth it to follow Jesus? And I want to tell you, yes, indeed. People from all over the world, all throughout the ages, will add their testimony to mine and say, yes, indeed. It's worth it to follow Jesus. There is still time for you to come to the front. It's really between you and God. It's your opportunity to say, Lord, I love you, and I want to follow you no matter what. To Jesus I surrender. Surrender everything to you right now. And we're asking that you will empower us to do this. We can't do it on our own, but through your power we can. There will be challenges, temptations, difficulties. But we are claiming the promise that he that is in us is infinitely greater than he that is in the world. What a wonderful promise we have. Lord, bless my friends over here. Some maybe are discouraged, lift them up. Some maybe are just drifting away, bring them back. Some are not feeling well, give them healing. Emotional, physical, spiritual. And Lord, maybe there is someone here who's thinking about you for the first time. I just pray that they will see how wonderful you are. And ultimately, really, in spite of all of our needs, the greatest need we have is to have more of you. So give us more of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. We invite all of you to stay for potluck. And right after potluck, come back. We will have two short presentations. One of them is how to share our faith in a natural way. How to be just inclined to tell other people how we love Jesus. Not going door to door, not doing any of that stuff, but just how naturally we could do it. And the second presentation, which I think all of you will be interested in this, is to tell you the story of the prodigal son from a Middle Eastern perspective. It would be something you never have heard before. This is the most common story in the entire Bible. And a theologian by the name of Kenneth Bailey spent 40 years studying this parable. So I will share some of his insights with you this afternoon. We will have them back to back. We will finish before 4 o'clock this afternoon. Come and eat with us. Enjoy your Sabbath. And I think we're going to collect the offering at the door.